This is the Commodore 128D, a version of the Commodore 128 designed for the professional market. This computer is a dream come true for any Commodore 8-bit enthusiast. It's both a Commodore 64 and a Commodore 128, with a built-in 1571 disk drive. The Commodore 128 features two processors, a MOS 8502 running at 2 MHz and a Zeti 80 at 4 MHz, which was added to allow it to run the CPM operating system. That system is actually quite fascinating, and I'd love to make a separate video later to dive deeper into it. In addition, the Commodore 128 included an 80-column text mode, which made it perfect for word processors and spreadsheets, a big deal for professional users at the time. The Commodore 128 succeeded modestly in the US, but less so in Europe. Amstrad CPC6128, with a Z80 CPU running faster and CPM support, offered similar 80-column displays at a lower cost. Unlike the Amstrad CPC6128, which was an upgrade of the CPC464, the C128 didn't truly enhance the C64. It only booted in C64 mode. Developers ignored its advanced features, targeting the dominant C64 instead. This was a shame. The extra 64 kilobytes could have acted like an REU in C64 mode, or the 80-column mode could have been accessible from it as well. Internal rivalry after the Amiga team joined Commodore, plus the rise of 16-bit systems like the Atari ST and affordable IBM PCs, further limited the C128's success. I've just received this Commodore 128D, but before plugging it in, let's take a look inside to make sure everything's in order. The first thing that catches my attention is the power supply. It looks like someone has used a PC power supply to replace the original one. It seems to still have the original 9-volt AC transformer, although it's come loose from the base and a few wires are hanging off. We'll need to check that. On the other hand, there's a real tangle of wires connected to the motherboard. We'll sort that out later with a more suitable power supply. But first, let's measure the voltages to make sure that the last time it was powered on, everything was working correctly. Let's take a look at the power supply pinout in the service manual for this computer. Here's the diagram. This machine requires 9 volts of alternating current and 5 volts of direct current to power the motherboard, plus 12 volts of direct current for the disk drive. Now that we have the pinout, let's go ahead and check the voltages. Pin 2 should output 12 volts DC. Pin 4 should output 5 volts DC. And pins 5 and 6 should provide 9 volts AC. It looks like there's been some kind of accident here at some point. I'd guess it was with the original power supply, but all the checks are fine now, so let's hope the computer itself isn't damaged. The 9 volts AC transformer is working correctly, so I'll just replace the DC power supply with one that's more suitable for this computer. We'll get rid of this mess of unnecessary cables and connections and bring a bit more order to the inside of this thing. I've replaced the DC power supply with a Meanwell RD50A, which provides the two voltage outputs we need, 5 and 12 volts. You can check out other videos on the channel where we've installed this same power supply in other computers before. Now everything looks much tidier, and since this power supply doesn't get too hot, I'm leaving out the noisy fan. I won't be putting this computer under heavy use anyway. Everything's connected now. Let's power it on for the first time. The computer powers on, and everything seems to be working fine. The disk drive has started up as well. That's a good sign. Although the computer powers on correctly and the disk drive spins up, when I insert a disk that I know is in good condition and was written by a properly calibrated drive, this machine doesn't read the directory. I can see that the head moves without any problem, but it's probably just dirty. I've tried formatting a disk with this computer, and it both formatted and read it without any problems. This usually happens when the drive is out of alignment. It can read disk formatted by itself, but not those written by other drives. So I'm going to proceed with aligning the head. To do that, we need to access the underside of the drive. There are two screws holding the head motor in place. They're sealed, but the seal might have come loose. We'll loosen them just a little, just enough so the head can be rotated a couple of degrees. To align the red head, we can either use an oscilloscope or do it through software. To load this software, I'm going to use a disk emulator, setting it up as drive 9, since the internal drive in this computer is always drive 8. The software I'm going to use is the Alignment Utility from Free Spirit Software, a program specifically made for this purpose. To align the head, we need a special disk that originally came with this software, or a disk that we know was formatted by a well-aligned drive. In my case, I'm going to use the demonstration disk from the 1541 drive, which I know has good enough quality to be used for calibration. This utility will show us the track currently being read, the track that should be read, and the alignment status. Using the keyboard, we can move forward or backward between tracks and watch the results. The read head will step forward or backward, also stopping at intermediate points between tracks. We'll gently rotate the motor that moves the head until we get at least a satisfactory result. My recommendation is to focus on the tracks themselves. That's where the important calibration happens, and not on the spaces in between. It's very difficult to get both positions perfectly aligned. After aligning the head, I tested it with several discs, and the results are a bit inconsistent. Most of them read correctly, but when checking the alignment again, it seems there might be some other kind of issue. I'm going to try a disc that I know works correctly, since I've tested it with other drives and it's worked without any issues. If this were an alignment problem, it wouldn't be able to read any part of the disc properly, or it would be very unlikely to read several consecutive tracks correctly. But instead, it seems to read the directory and the intro just fine, then stops working when it tries to load the main game. After spending some time inspecting the drive, I notice that the head isn't sitting straight. It's slightly tilted to the right. Very carefully and without applying pressure, just resting my finger gently on the left side of the head to level it, I'll try loading the game again. I'll try to level the read head by adjusting the screws that hold down the metal plate supporting the head arm. The screws are sealed and a bit worn, so this is going to be a delicate operation. The game finally loads correctly. After that, I tested several more discs, and they all work perfectly without any issues. So it looks like we can now fully enjoy this wonderful computer. It's advisable to keep the head protector inserted and the drive door closed whenever the unit is going to be stored or transported. This way, we can avoid possible damage to the mechanism by keeping it locked in place, and the protector will absorb any shocks or vibrations that might affect the head. It's finally time to fully enjoy this wonderful computer with one of my favorite Commodore games. I hope you like this video. Subscribe to the channel to help it grow, and don't forget to hit the like button if you found it interesting. See you soon!